Welcome to the White Fund Lecture Series. We're very glad to be having it here at Heritage State Park. We're very thrilled to be in the community room. So thank you very much to the people at Heritage State Park. The White Fund has, there's a trustee here from the White Fund, Jay Dowd, back there, yeah. Myself, and then Eileen O'Connor-Bennell. I'm going to just read a little bit from the White's will. He left a will in 1852 saying that he wanted to have a lecture series here in Lawrence for the workers in the mill. And sometimes when I think about that, I think that's right there, so incredible. He left land here in Lawrence, said sell the land, use the money to begin a library, and then have a lecture series that goes on forever, 6 lectures each year. He wrote that the lectures were to be available to the mill workers, to the people working in the mills who didn't maybe have the opportunity to have a formal education, and that it should be available for both men and women, and that we want to continue that. We want to continue to make sure that we have this series here in Lawrence for the people in Lawrence. Jay brought in a piece of information here, or something off the walls of the White Fund history, and it shows that in 1939, the guest speaker for the White Fund was Robert Frost. So his granddaughter is here today to continue this legacy, both of Daniel White and the legacy of literacy or literature and great literature and great poetry that is the city of Lawrence, beginning with Robert Frost and moving on from there. We're very lucky also that in the room today we have many important people, but especially I'm going to say Mark Shore. Mark's is a member and works so hard for the Frost Foundation here to keep this legacy of literature and writing alive, and brings all ages, youth, all ages into the realm of poetry and sharing poetry and writing poetry. And he was the reason that we have our guest speaker today. He came to me and said, you know what, I have a good idea. What about? And I thought, wow, I didn't know we could bring in the granddaughter of Robert Frost. That's quite amazing. So first I would like to have Mark Shore come up and say a few words to get this going. So thank you.
Thank you, Mary, and thank you, Jay, for giving us context for one of the oldest and longest continuous lecture series in American literature. At the other end, Ralph Waldo Emerson gave this lecture, and Robert Frost gave it several times. And it's a real pleasure to welcome Leslie Lee Francis back to Lawrence, Massachusetts, to where her grandfather and grandmother met, got a first-class high school education at Lawrence High School, fell in love, and married. And it is the place where Robert Frost and Eleanor Frost published his first poem and embarked on the great journey of his poetry. Leslie Lee Francis has devoted much of her life to making sure that her grandmother and grandfather and mother's legacy is well preserved, and she has also cared for the legacy of her remarkable mother, Leslie Frost. Now, because of Leslie's book, we now have many of the best stories of the Frost family in one place, as a future reference to students of Frost poetry and future biographers. Because of her balanced perspective, future biographers will understand her grandfather's life, and all of us can rejoice that she has preserved that sense of family so clearly. I most value that balanced perspective which has helped me all these years and our small foundation read the early poems of Robert and Eleanor in Lawrence and Derry. And Leslie Francis gives some of her own readings in the book as well. For many years, she's convened an annual gathering of Frost scholars and has encouraged the ideas that have kept Frost scholarship as state of the art. You Come To also tells the story of how the Frost Foundation, of how Leslie Francis and the Frost family have helped every nonprofit organization, large or small, to care for her Frost legacy. And today she's accompanied by her sister, Eleanor Wilbur, Eleanor's daughter, Marcia, I believe, Leslie's daughter, Christiana, and we're so glad that she's here to talk to us today.
I always have warfare with mics, so tell me. In the back row, my sister's sitting way back there. Can you hear me, Eleanor? Is that a yes or a no? It means you don't hear me. Can you hear me? Okay, what about over here? Can you hear me? Because yesterday I gave a talk at the Stone House over in Shaftesbury, and they had no mic. And furthermore, we met in a barn, and there was an overflow, which is lovely to have an overflow, but they had to stand outside in the sun and the heat. And I know they couldn't hear me, and I had no mic, so I was yelling, and I'm still hoarse. I'm still hoarse today. So it's wonderful to be here in Lawrence, and Mark is one of the people I most admire, and there are others too, Gary Keating and Natalie. It's nice to see you, and I forget names, so it's my trouble. But it's wonderful to see all of you here, and I have a classmate here, Alicia, and her husband are here, a classmate from college, and that's back in the day, right, Alicia? I'm learning to say back in the day now. If I can't remember what year it was, I say, oh, back in the day, you know? Because I used to say, it's such and such, like 10 years ago, and my daughters will say, oh, Mom, it was 20 years ago. I can't go through that every day. The book, indeed, is something I'm quite pleased to have done. University of Virginia Press has been a wonderful press for me. I have a lot of associations with the University of Virginia. They have, probably after Dartmouth, the best Frost collection in the country. And I'll mention in passing probably later the little book, Twilight, that he put together of his first poems and took over to Eleanor at St. Lawrence University in Canton, New York. And he had two copies, one for himself and one for her. Now, this was right after they had graduated co-valedictorian of their Lawrence High School class. And you all probably already know that he was the one that was chosen as valedictorian. He was Mr. Cool on campus. He was on the football team. He was on the baseball team. He was in the debating society where he was defending the Indians. And he was also class poet and class president too. I'm not sure about that. But he was named valedictorian of his graduating class. This was in 1892. And he said, I'll do it, but you have to name Eleanor White as my co-valedictorian. So if nothing else, what I accomplished today with you is to remind you how important the women were in Robert Frost's life. And you will see the book, if you get to it, that you will see that I mention a lot of women that are connected with Robert Frost. And of course, not only Eleanor White, but his mother, Isabel Moody from Scotland, was a tremendous influence on the child during those critical years in San Francisco before they moved to Lawrence. The book is entitled You Come To, and it comes from... It comes from... What? I can't hear it.
The first book.
The Pasture. Is that what you said? You said The Pasture? I didn't sound, I couldn't hear it. I guess because we're all talking at once. I'll just read it to remind you. And this poem, by the way, he put it at the very beginning of his book in his 1949 collection. He had that poem right at the front of his book. And the next question I'm going to ask you is, why would he put it at the front of his whole collection. Because one of the more recent critics, who will go nameless at this moment, decided that this was a very sad poem, because in those farm days back in the day, you would go out and get the, you know, out where the mother of the calf was, and you'd take the calf away from the mother and take it away, which is a cruel thing to do. So please, please, think of it the way Robert Frost did. First place, it's a love poet, love poem rather, and secondly, it is an invitation, right? It is not a sad poem. I'm going out to clean the pasture spring. I'll only stop to rake the leaves away and wait to watch the water clear, I may. I shan't be gone long. You come too. I'm going out to fetch the little calf that's standing by the mother. It's so young it totters when she licks it with her tongue. I shan't be gone long. You come too. I always think of it as I always think of Eleanor in the kitchen, of course, because that's where she did not want to be. But he says, you know, I'm just going out this spring, you know, to clean the spring. And this modern critic said, you don't have to clean the spring. But anyway, whatever. So it's an invitation, right, to her to come. That when I chose that as the title of the book, I immediately called Henry Holton Company, his publisher his whole life. He was told when he returned from England in 1915 that he already had a publisher, which was Henry Holton Company, and he stayed with them the rest of his life. But I called them immediately when my publisher agreed to use that title. I said, what is it? Is there some copyright on this, you know? Because he published a poem, a selected poem for young readers, and called it You Come Too as well. So I thought I'd better find out whether this was legal. And she said, well, I'll call you right back. I have to talk to the legal department. So she calls me back and said, no, there is no copyright on a title, just so you'll know that. So then when you put a title on your next book, don't worry about the copyright, okay? Even if somebody else has used it before you. People ask me, and it's different when I talk about the book, they always ask me, well, two main things. Did I know my grandfather? I consider that a compliment, because I was in my 30s when he died. And how much contact did I have? I mean, well, I have to mention the two major events that you will know about, and that is the inauguration of John F. Kennedy. I don't know where you were at that time. Some of you may not have even been born at that point. But I was teaching at Sweetbriar College in Virginia at that time. By the way, my field is Romance Languages. It is not English. I never took a course in English, which I'm confessing to you right now. But when the inauguration came along, remember that Jack Kennedy had heard through Stuart Udall and others that Frost was running around New England saying that New England was not dead yet. It's not dead yet. It's not in decay. And in fact, probably the next president of the United States is going to be from New England. He's just a senator. And of course, everybody knew who he was talking about, because Jack Kennedy was already in the picture. Well, when he got word of that, that Frost was doing that, he was charmed by that. And Udall said, you know, why don't you just invite him to come and read a poem at the inauguration, so that you know that's the background to it. And of course he did, and he read, do you remember what poem he recited? He did not read it, as you know. He had a poem that he had written for the occasion, and he couldn't recite it. The Gift Outright, very good. Now you're getting into the spirit of the thing here. All right, so The Gift Outright.
I'll take some water here.
He could not read the one that he had prepared for the occasion. And LBJ tried to put his hat over it, and that didn't work. And he was a long time making up his mind that he just couldn't do it. But he remembered purely from memory, in that very cold, blusty day, the land was ours before we were the land's. She was our land more than 100 years before we were her people. She was ours in Massachusetts, in Virginia, but we were England's, still colonials, possessing what we still were possessed by what we now no more possessed. Something we were withholding made us weak, until we found out that it was ourselves we were withholding from our land of living, and forthwith found salvation in surrender. Such as we were, we gave ourselves outright. The deed of gift was many deeds of war. To the land vaguely realizing westward, but unstoried, artless, unenhanced. Such as she was, such as she would become. Do you remember it? Some of you did. You're probably sitting in your living rooms with a television. Oh, thank you. Thank you. So that was certainly a big occasion for me. I came up in my little Volkswagen Beetle from Amherst, Virginia, just down south of Washington. And there was a big storm. It was a terrible blizzard the day before. And immediately, I mean, within 1 mile, I had to stop and put chains on. Now, that's really back in the day. We put chains on our tires when we're in a blizzard. So I put the chains on, and the windshield wiper was freezing. And as I went up Route 29, the cars were being abandoned along the road, and many trucks had been simply jackknifed and gone off the road. And that's how I knew where the road was, because I just went between the cars. And I made it to Washington. And some family members were there. My sister was also there. And so it was a great occasion for us. And we went, Frost was very depressed afterwards, and I have to emphasize that because, you know, again, these modern critics, they love to upstage the poet too. And so they said, oh, he must have been trying to upstage the president by not being able to read his own poem or whatever. But he was very, very unhappy that he messed that up. But the gift outright, he recited it because I went to the Kennedy Library up in Boston and listened to it. They brought out the tape and the whole thing. We watched it. And it was just amazing after realizing that he couldn't read that poem, that with such power he was able to stand there and recite from memory. He was 80, how old was he in 61? He was 86, 86 or 87. So he wasn't a young man anymore, but he handled that as well as you possibly could. And the other thing people ask me, well, the other event I should mention too is the trip that he took in 1957 to England to get honorary degrees at Oxford, Cambridge, Durham, and the University of Dublin. I was able to be there for the first two, for Cambridge and Oxford. I was working in the embassy in Madrid at that time and flew over to London. So that was an exciting event as well. I mean, just the poets that you would be meeting there, you know, T.S. Eliot and so on. But those were public performances, and I mentioned them for another reason, not just because I was there, but because once Eleanor died in 1938, his life changed. And it changed because she hated that kind of public life. She did not like that at all. She wanted poetry to be kind of a private thing for them, at least until after they died. And that didn't work out that way. She died relatively young, 1938. But then during those final years, I think it was a lot in his mind that he was going to sort of have a last hurrah. You know, he was going to have a good time for the last years that were granted to him. And so he was 88 when he died. So he went to Jerusalem on a fellowship there, to Hebrew University. He went to São Paulo in Brazil to attend on behalf of the State Department to attend the World Congress of Writers with Faulkner. And that awakened in him a curiosity he had always had, and that was an interest in archaeology and in pre-colonial history. And it was really that part of his interest that got me into studying Robert Frost. You will know, because you're in Lawrence, that at the high school, when he was walking around on the campus of the high school here, he suddenly realized that a poem had come to him, and he claimed later that that was the very first poem he wrote. It was not a very good poem. It was a ballad, and it was called La Noche Triste. Now, those of you who know Spanish know exactly what La Noche Triste means, right?
The sad night.
Yes, but why would Robert Frost, as a teenager who didn't know a word of Spanish, really, I mean, never studied Spanish, he never studied modern languages because he didn't want it to interfere with his ear for the English language, especially for the language spoken up here. And so I was curious about that. I wanted to know. I mean, I saw among the uncollected poems, because that was an uncollected poem, as it should have been, why this ballad was named La Noche Triste. Because La Noche Triste goes back to 1520, so you'll know if you remember your history, that in 1520, Cortez and his band of Spaniards were trying to conquer what was then called Tenochtitlan. Tenochtitlan was the name the Aztecs gave to, the Aztecs gave to the city that is today Mexico City. It was surrounded by water and causeways, and Cortez got there with not only the soldiers that he took with him from Spain, but he also had, put together a whole coalition, that's a good word, a coalition of tribes that hated Moctezuma. And they hated him because whenever they caught one of their soldiers, they would, you know, cut their hearts out and other unpleasant things. So he, through a translator, he had managed to get a whole bunch of tribes to to work with him in defeating the great Moctezuma. But he didn't succeed on the first try. And so that's the La Noche Triste comes from that, just so you know, 1520. They attacked along those causeways up into Tenochtitlan, but they were defeated, they were pushed back. And that night that they spent defeated for a brief time was called La Noche Triste. And it was a big, enormous tree that lasted until 1949 before it fell down. Excuse me. So that was sort of an introduction for me to something that had a Spanish connection, because my main language at that point was Spanish. And then I realized that from things I had read, that he got into the, he got into the pre-colonial history through Prescott's History and the Conquest of Mexico, which is a very well-known book at that time, again, probably not today. I don't know if anybody reads even reads history anymore, but anyway, the History of the Conquest of Mexico was a big history that Frost had read in high school. And it made a big impression on him. And as I say, in the debating society, he wanted the Indians to win all the time and to have the treaties honored and so forth. And so that's what got me started. And I started writing articles. I did a lot about, my first article was called Majesty of Stones, because he'd been in Israel and was remarking on the stones and what he referred to as one civilization upon another. And then I got interested as well in the dynamics of the family, and that's what led me to realize more about the women, about Belle Moody, about Eleanor, of course, and the children. And as you know, of the, the surviving children, there were three women and one boy. The older boy had died before they got to the farm and dairy. So that was another theme that interested me a great deal, the women and the children. And so now that I'm retired from my teaching and from the American Association of University Professors, where I was on the staff and running a school in Spain, I started to create courses that I could teach to adults, and that is really fun. If anybody here wants to have fun, think up a good course to teach to any adult programs you have around here. I don't know whether the community colleges have them.
Yes.
I don't know whether the elite schools have them.
Northern Essex Community College.
Do they have an adult program? It's so much fun. I mean, you meet people not maybe as old as I am, but they're getting up there. Yeah, it's great fun. So I created over many years now, it's been years, four different courses on Frost. And I'll just mention one of them to you. All of this material, by the way, comes up in the book. There's no mystery involved here. But one of them that I had fun doing was just to take the word love, L-O-V-E. And the first thing I realized that you really can't talk about love in the abstract. I can't, maybe you can, you know. But it really doesn't work as an abstraction. It has to be a love of something. But you're not talking about romantic love necessarily. Because with our students, they always wanted the romantic love first. And then I said, no, that's going to be the last week. We don't get to that. So you know, here I have a little outline of that course. I'm not going to do all the course with you here, but just to give you an idea, maybe I should ask you first, what other kinds of love would, well, think a little bit about Frost, because that's what we're doing right now.
Nature,
yeah. And you know, we always just say, nature, that's all right. But if you look at my poems, I think he said there was one, I don't know, maybe two, but one poem where there were no people. So now that's your exercise. That's your assignment, is to see if you can find any poems by Robert Frost that do not have any people in them. So he always, when people talk about nature poets and nature this and that, I said, yeah, that's okay. But then if you watch that Voices and Visions, did you ever see that? They did a series on television of different poets and so forth. The very beginning of that has him sitting there saying, nature is cruel. That's the way he starts out, nature is cruel. And he gives us an example, the trees fighting to get into the space above. Nature is cruel, and it is. And then when he was supposed to say something nice about the United Nations, he came up with some lines for their statue that they were going to put in front of the building. So nature within her inmost self divides to trouble man with having to take sides. And notice the great rhyme there. Nature within her inmost self divides to trouble man with having to take sides. Now that wasn't exactly what they had in mind. Huh? What? Yeah, right. Okay, well, nobody's come up. Nature's one to come up with. And I even have it here, Robert Nature, and I was going to read a poem. Something else.
Repeat the question, please, ma'am.
Excuse me?
Repeat the question, please.
What kinds of love might Robert Frost have been writing about other than romantic love? What she did was a good love poet, by the way.
Huh? Family.
Family? Did you say family? Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'll just get going here. The one I've already read to you was The Gift Outright. And that, what kind of love would you put with that?
Country.
Yeah, country.
Yeah.
Country, love of country. If you have a chance to read, be careful here. If you have a chance to read his essay called Poetry, what is it called? Oh, gee. Education by Poetry. I don't know why I forget that. I've used it as a title sometimes for my talks. Education by Poetry. It's an essay that appears in the book that I use most, which is the Library of America edition of Frost, because it has the uncollected poems. Not that he would have appreciated that, but the uncollected poems are there and a great deal of his prose. And it was a correction of the Latham book, which had taken some liberties with the 1949 edition of collected poems. And the most serious one that Donald Hall kept complaining about was adding a comma to a line in Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. Do you know what that is? The woods are lovely, dark, and deep. And then, you know, yes, there's a comma. I can't do it without the poem in front of me, but there is a comma that Latham put in there that didn't belong, and it changed the meter and it changed the meaning, actually. And there were other examples of that, but it got corrected in this Library of America edition. So I recommend it. The print's very fine. I don't like that part of it, but it's a good book. And it's Mark Richardson is the main editor of that. Love of country. So then if I were doing this as a course, one of the poems that we would certainly look at is The Gift Outright. But there are others. America is Hard to See. There are a lot of poems we could talk about.
Work. What about just work?
Excuse me?
He loved work.
Yeah, I've got that here, Love of Labor. Yeah, that comes up, that's good, that's a good one. Love of Country, then the next one I just talked about is Love of History and the pre-colonial history and so forth, and I just talked about that. Love of Labor, yeah, I'll read a little, I have it here, I think, I hope so, I can find it. There's a poem called Two Tramps in Mud Time that I want to read, just one stanza out of it, if I can find it here. I wasn't planning to read it right now, but I'm going to read it right now. I can find it quickly. The Two Tramps in Mud Time, if you may recall, is the narrator who's chopping wood.
Twins, in case you want.
Oh, thank you, dear. Yeah, I got a little hoarse after yesterday. So I don't think I'm going to find my little excerpt here. I hope I do. I know it's here because I saw it a minute ago. Oh, maybe it's because it's over here. Okay, now I've got it, I think. No, not so sure. Here it is. When I do these talks, I keep changing what I start to talk about. I got it. Thank you, dear. I'll remember that you helped me, though. Okay, this is just a stanza from Two Tramps in Mud Time, and I was starting to say he's cutting wood and he's enjoying himself, and there's the vernal heat and his muscles are rippling, and he's happy, very happy. And then he sees two tramps coming out of the woods. He knows right away what that means. It means that they want his job for need. They have the need of money. But it ends, the poem ends, it's really the idea of love versus need. I mean, is love more important than need, or need more important than love? Now he concludes in this poem that the need is more important. But the way he ends the poem is a little bit different. Excuse me. But you who will to their separation, my object in living is to unite my avocation with my vocation, as my two eyes make one in sight. Only where love and need are one, and the work is play for mortal stakes, is the deed ever really done for heaven and the future's sake. So that's how he ends the. So you have to ask yourselves, because I can speak of my own life, but I can't speak about any of yours. How many of you feel that you've reached that point where your avocation and your vocation are one and the same? She says she, really, Natalie, okay. You do also? Well, that's a wonderful thing. That's a wonderful thing. Because then your emotion, your passion, is joined with what's the work you're doing. And in some ways, when I took on the Frost biography, which was rather late in life, I mean, I really was almost retired, but I got to it. It had been working its way up through me, because when my mother followed Frost down to São Paulo for the World Congress of Writers, she came back with all these clippings. In what language?
Portuguese.
Portuguese, right? Well, she didn't know Portuguese. She knew Spanish, but she didn't know Portuguese. I didn't know much Portuguese, but I knew some because my degree was in Romance languages, so I had to study a couple of other languages besides Spanish. So she put them on my desk and she said, do something with these. And there were all these pile of clippings about Frost's time in São Paulo. So I started reading through them, you know, and the Portuguese is enough like Spanish that I get it. And the one that really caught me was a photo of the man that went with him. Faulkner was in his hotel room, and the reporters caught up with him there. He was a recluse. He didn't want to meet anyone. And he ultimately left early to go home because his daughter was getting married or something. But he didn't meet the reporters. Frost did. He didn't know any Portuguese either, of course. But he had translators, and he could joke with them. He knew how to joke with them. He knew how to make them happy. And so he was meeting with the reporters all the time, but not Faulkner. And they caught up with him in his hotel room. And this clipping, which had the photo of him, underneath it said, he went up, that he, Faulkner, holding his martini in a hand, walked over to the window, and he said, my, how Chicago has changed. And I thought this reporter must have had a really good sense of humor. But I took all those things, and that was when I started to realize how much Frost liked the pre-colonial history, because he collected some gems from down there that he brought back, and then he said, I've got to get to an archaeological dig before I leave South America. He didn't want to go all that long trip on that airplane. That was one of the first airplane trips that he took. And so he agreed to go on a small plane over the Andes to Lima, Peru. And he and my mother went with him. They went over there. He knew an archaeologist that would take him out to the digs. And out he went, and he found some little thing that he took home with him. So that got me interested in that whole aspect of his life. And the Two Tramps in Mud Time, I give that as love of labor. But you can see it in Death of the Hired Man. You can see it in a lot of the narrative poems in a Boy's Will, but in North of Boston. And then, was it Mark, did you mention the children? Did you mention the children? Somebody did. Natalie, I don't know, one of you did. The love of children, of course, that was one that I focused on a great deal for obvious reasons. And the life on the dairy farm fascinated me because of the at-home education. The talk I gave yesterday was on his ideas on education, and I don't have time for that. But that's where he practiced what he thought. He was very ambivalent. He said, I'm imperfectly academic. I love to teach, but I hate schools. And he would do anything. And he ultimately said to the students, he said, you need to go, just go. Whatever it is you're planning to do, go do it. Don't stay here. And then he says, if they stay without going, he's advised them to go. And if they stay, then I can teach them with a good conscience, you see. They've stayed at their peril, as they say. So his attitudes on education are very interesting. But when he had the children on the farm, it's really amazing what they did, really. You couldn't replicate it today, I mean, because the whole system is so entirely different. But there they were with the four children, and they had to write, and they had to write every day. And they were supposed to have a title, a beginning, a middle, and an end, and a denouement of some kind. What have we got? So I'm going to read a couple of poems from that time. But if you have a chance to look for a book in the library, I couldn't bring all these books up here with me. But the one you want to be sure to look at, either at the dairy farm or here in Lawrence, is my mother's journals from that period. For about 5 years, she wrote her journals. And it's a remarkable book. It was published in 1969 by the State University of New York, in facsimile. All of the journals, everything that she wrote for 5 years in there, from the age of 5 to the age of 10 and 11, are right there to look at. And what surprised me when I first looked at that book, when I was doing research and everything, was that there were no comments, no marks on those essays, nothing. My mother, for example, would write her essay that she was assigned to do, not telling her what to talk right about, but telling her she had to write something. She would take that to her father, and they would discuss it, but no marks of any kind. Her mother would teach grammar, spelling, mathematics, and a number of other subjects. But he kind of did more with geography, botany, and astronomy. Those were his favorites. They'd take these long walks, because he was good in botany. He was very good. He was something of a botanist, amateur, of course. But the way that they developed the children to write well was by writing, just by writing. And I said there wasn't a mark on there. I mean, I kept going through the book to see if I could find some little comment or there was a lot of misspelling. My mother learned to write on the typewriter at the age of 3. And then when she got more agile with her hands, she started by the age of 5 to be writing in longhand. Very phonetic, nothing spelled right. Don't expect that, but it's really a remarkable record. Then when they moved to England in 1912, the children created a journal they called the Bouquet, which was, they had contributions from children from other families, but it was primarily my mother as the editor of this, and they have illustrations. Again, another book that I couldn't bring with me, but it was published in England called As Told to a Child, because under two poems that I can think of where he wrote later that it was told as told to the child, and I'll read one of them right now if I can find it. So while the children were working on their essays and all this kind of thing, they'd sit in the living room at the dairy farm and have classes there, and then they'd go into the kitchen and show their dad, father, what they had done, and then do exercises and all this. And then the big events were always walking in the woods, that kind of thing, with Robert Frost. So there was a lot of interaction that way, and they all had a love of astronomy, and they had a little telescope, and they would get named after the constellations and stuff. I'm going to find this particular poem here. I had these in an order at one time, but the trouble is I change the order when I'm speaking, and then I can't find them in the same order. Very frustrating. Oh, well, I'll find it in a minute. There it is. That's what I was looking for. Okay, this one is called The Last Word of a Bluebird. It had a much longer title at first, but that reminds me that the Frost did what he would do is to write little stories for the children. And those were published in the same book, As Told to a Child. And you see The Last Word of a Bluebird appeared later on with his writing underneath it, As Told to a Child. And he would read those stories to the children, and they just, oh, they just loved it, because they were the characters. The dog was a character, Schneider the dog was a character. And they would talk, you know, the dog could talk, of course, and everybody could talk. excuse me. I'll drink a little more water. You have to blame the stone house for this. But we always loved this poem. As I went out, a crow in a low voice said, "Oh, I was looking for you. How do you do? I just came to tell you to tell Leslie," that's my mother, "will you, that her little bluebird wanted me to bring word that the north wind last night that made the stars bright and made ice on the trough almost made him cough his tail feathers off. He just had to fly, but he sent her goodbye and said to be good and wear her red hood and look for skunk tracks in the snow with an axe and do everything, and perhaps in the spring he would come back and sing." It's a great little poem. And he wrote that, of course, my mother's name is in there. It's because she was always worried about the birds coming, leaving and not coming back. I don't think there's anyone other from that group. I'm going to put that over there. Okay, so I talk about the children. There's so much you can say about it, but the bouquet came out like once a month, and it was distributed one single copy, because of course they didn't have any of this photocopying business, so they would make one issue of it with illustrations that they did themselves, all the painting, the artwork, because Eleanor had a big interest in art. Her sister was a rather successful painter, and so she taught the children how to paint, and they really preferred to paint than write when they had a choice, which they didn't, but anyway. So in this bouquet that they did over in England, illustrations are all by the children, and they really, some of them are amazing, actually. Six of those issues were saved by Eleanor. There were probably 12 altogether, but six of them were saved, and they are now, as a gift, they are now in the University of Virginia Library. And so they have them there, and once in a while they put one of them up on the internet. But if you ever go to Virginia, you can come see me, or you can go to the University of Virginia and see all the Frost things that are there, including Twilight, which is that, I don't think I finished that story. He took the Twilight to Eleanor, but I'm gonna get into romantic love, so maybe I'll save it for that. I love of children, we can say a great deal about it, but if you have a chance to even look at those journals of my mother, you'll get a clear idea of what they did there on the farm. Another one I wrote down here for love was Brotherhood. And the reason it's so important in Frost's life is that when he was in England, he met a man named Edward Thomas, who later, because of Frost's urging, became a poet himself. Edward Thomas did. He's very honored in England now. But he had never written any poems before he met Robert Frost. And he had just published a book called In Pursuit of Spring. He was a writer. He did a lot of commissioned work and had biographies and nature books. He went around on his bicycle and wrote about nature. And he just published a book called In Pursuit of Spring, because he was from Wales, and he would go up into Wales and come up with these essays. And Frost said, "Look, that's poetry in there, but no one's going to know it unless you get it out of there and publicize it." So they became very, very, very close friends during that time in England. Unfortunately for Robert is that Edward wanted to enlist the minute the war started. The war changed everything in England in 1914. You remember that date, right? But August 1914. And so they were in England at that time, and all the publishing started. Everybody had, if they had any physical strength at all, enlisted. They didn't have to be young. And Edward was up in his upper 30s, but he agonized over whether he didn't have to enlist, but he did finally. And he was killed almost immediately when he got to France. And he trained for a while before that, but he wanted to be sent to France, and that's where he was sent. And he was killed there. So that was a terrible loss for Robert. And they had planned to bring Edward to the United States. They brought his son back with them in 1915. But he went back to England, and Edward, of course, died, so that was that. There were three children. And those children contributed to the bouquet, I will add that in. There's a beautiful poem I don't have time to read now, but I urge it upon you. It's Iris by Night. He wrote two poems about Edward. One was called To E.T., Edward Thomas, which is it's a good poem, but does not reach the level of Iris by Night. Now, Iris, when I've had my adult students assign Iris by Night, if they haven't read it, and I say, what is Iris? If they don't answer that correctly, then I know they haven't read the poem. So has anybody here read the poem Iris by Night and know what Iris is standing for? Nobody? Come on, Gary.
I don't want to be the smart guy.
Excuse me? Iris by Night? Iris is a rainbow. It's a rainbow. And it's a rainbow that encircled them as elected friends. Okay, it's a beautiful poem. Beautiful poem. It's one of my favorites, but of course I know the story of Edward and Robert. It talks about how he's remained behind. So it was a poem he wrote about Edward after a good time had passed by after he died, because at first he wrote that to E.T. and it's just not quite to his level. You've mentioned love of nature, and of course that's important, to nature all the way through his poems, but you have to, he always said education by poetry is education by metaphor, indirection, irony, all those things, all those elements that come into it. And you do that when you have people. The trees don't do that. The plants don't do that. They're just the setting, you know. Now, the Romantic poets, of course, had kind of a talking back and forth between nature and, I don't even know what that, you guys who studied English a lot, what is that called? Something, is it the pathetic fallacy? Pathetic. Come on, who's the English teacher here? What's it called? Pathetic fallacy? Yeah. Well, okay. I just call it an interaction between people and nature, okay? So when you read a poem like To Look at Two, if you want to have an example, To Look at Two, this is where the couple, Eleanor and Robert, are probably, I've not been able to verify that, they go up into the woods up there near Franconia, and they see two deer, a buck and a doe, that go by, and that's what the poem is about. And it's the closest Frost comes to feeling the emotion of an interaction with the animals and with the nature that he's experiencing there. So read that with that sort of romantic idea in mind, and it's pleasing, you know? It's nice. But in general, he has poems where, what is the one about being versed in country things? I think the Phoebe. Yeah. There, you know, he's pointing out the reality that the birds love it when it's all destroyed and the building is destroyed and so forth. But they're living in a different world. And there's another one, I'm not thinking of the title right now, but also about seeing a big buck go through the water. I forget the mask. What is it called? No, I can't remember. I've talked about the women in the book, and I mentioned this one more time. Belle Moody was a tremendous influence on Robert Frost. She was a Swedenborgian, and I could spend a lot of time talking about her. And she introduced him to poetry. She wrote poetry herself. She was something of a mystic through the Swedenborgian thing. But she read to him out loud well past the years that he could read himself. He kept reading books to him, reading them out loud, and kept him home from school, too, I might add. And so he had to come to Lawrence to get an education, right? And she would be my number one mention. But there were editors that were important. Women at that time, it was hard for them to be successful poets. There were poets. I mean, as you know, there are poets that have succeeded. Amy Lowell was one of them that praised Frost and helped get him introduced to the American public. And Ezra Pound was another one, but not a woman in that case. But Amy Lowell was quick to see the talent in Frost. And when he arrived on the boat in 1915 into New York, there was her article with the poems from north of Boston with her incredible praise. She just adored him, continued to adore him, even though the men kind of teased her a little bit, Amy Lowell. So then the other ones that I talk about at quite length in the book, Susan Hayes Ward, and she's the one that accepted his first poem for publication in the New York Independent, which was, she was the literary editor of the New York Independent in 1894, when My Butterfly was published on the front page of the New York Independent. Now that was when he had taken Twilight over to Eleanor, and he had had this privately printed, and just a few poems, and if you go into the uncollected poems of the Library of America edition, you'll see those poems listed, because they, not all of them were collected. My Butterfly was collected. And he carried one copy to her and kept one for himself. And when he got there, she was embarrassed. He didn't know, she didn't know he was coming. He had to get on a train. If anybody knows where Canton, New York is, it was a long way from Lawrence. And he gets there and he goes to where she's living. It's a house, actually, but it's a dormitory where they have the women. She finished college in 3 years, and I'll say something more about that. But he handed her one copy of Twilight, kept one for himself, and she looked dismayed. I mean, dismayed at having this gentleman, suitor, come there and appear and hand her this book. And so he didn't think she seemed appreciative at all, of course, and he thought that she must have met somebody else and it was all over. So he took his copy and destroyed it like that. So in the world, there was only one copy of Twilight. And I mentioned that it's now at the University of Virginia. They have it in a vault. It took a long time for C. Walter Barrett, who was the big collector of Frost, and did it. He was in the industry and had enough money. And he was working up in New York, and he told me before he died that he hated having lunch with the people he worked with all day. He was so, found it so boring. So he would go out and go around to the different bookstores in New York, and there are a lot of them, with used books and old books and so on. And they got to know him, and so they say, oh, Mr. Barrett, I found this wonderful thing for you. So he started collecting Frost and Faulkner and a number of others, and he ultimately gave that whole collection. He wanted to find Twilight, the one copy of Twilight. And eventually he did. I don't know what he paid for it, I have no idea. But he bought it and put it in the University of Virginia Library. I have a replica of it at home. I've seen the original, but they have to bring it up out of the vault. Finishing up on the love thing, let's just say a little bit about the romantic love, because you have to finish with that. And Eleanor was the love of his life. I mean, it was her death in 1938 was devastating for him. He resigned from Amherst College, where he'd been this whole, that was his main college throughout his life. He did teach other places at University of Michigan, at Dartmouth and Harvard and so forth. But Amherst was the main place where he taught. He resigned when she died down in Florida. I was there, actually. And his friends, his close friends, didn't think he'd ever see him again. He was in such bad shape. But there's where Kay Morrison came into the picture. He didn't know what to do. He was out of Amherst. And she pulled them together. And so people ask me, what do you think of Kay Morrison? I say, if she hadn't existed, we'd have to invent her. Because he needed someone to take charge. And she did that. There wasn't any other place, logically, for him to go and hang out. So she got him. He knew a lot of people at Harvard and other colleges, of course. So they hired him at Harvard. I don't think President Conan thought much of it. They only paid him like $2,000 a year to teach there. And but he taught there a number of years, and then he went to Dartmouth, and then he went back to Amherst. But Eleanor was, it's very hard when you talk about Eleanor, because whenever someone is as famous as Robert Frost, it's very hard to know what to say about the woman in his life. And people tended just to think she was kind of a drag on him, or she just was sort of hanging around. That's not true of Eleanor. Eleanor was a very high opinion. In fact, I wrote something here that I took out of my book that I can read to you, and it might be a good way to kind of end. This is in my book. This is a quote from my book. There is no question that Eleanor could hold her own intellectually. She was determined to complete her studies at St. Lawrence University before agreeing to marry the impatient suitor, and he was very impatient. I didn't mention that he got so depressed after giving her Twilight that he went off to the Dismal Swamp in North Carolina and got lost. And some hunters found him there, and he had to write to his mother to send him enough money to get home. He was completely lost. And I think maybe because of or in spite of this behavior on his part, she agreed finally to marry him. But it was very dramatic. It was very dramatic. And he got home, and that was when he found out that his first poem had been published by Susan Hayes Ward. And they remained friends for the rest of his life, the rest of her life, and was a very important woman in his life and as an editor. And when she was dying up in Berwick, Maine, he went up there to talk to her, and she was already blind and very close to death at that time. And she said to him, "You need to write a poem about women as the way you did about men in Birches, about boys in Birches. You don't have one about women." Does anybody know what that poem is? Oh my gosh, you people. You're all supposed to be such frost. He wrote it, he said it was one of the few times that he ever wrote a poem on demand, so to speak. She told the story of her childhood adventure that she'd had with her brother. Anybody getting it? Okay, I'll tell you. Wild grapes. Now you write it down and you read it, okay? Wild grapes. And it was the one that he wrote for Susan Hayes Ward in recollecting the memory of her childhood, where she's trying to reach the grapes up in the tree and her brother is teasing her, and she's just very little at that time. She gets caught up there and she can't get down, and she's clinging it like a baby does, you know, I mean, he's absolutely fastened there, paralyzed and feared. And then he keeps teasing her, "Can't you know how to get down? Don't you know how to get down?" And he finally gets her down. And the last lines in that poem, if you want to look, somebody wants to look it up and read them, I don't have that, I do not have that here. But the final lines of Wild Grapes are lovely, are very lovely lines. Why don't you look it up, Christiana, and I'll get you or Gary to read it, or somebody who has enough voice. My eyes are causing me trouble now in my older years, and I'm going to have a cataract removed, so I can't read my own book.
How much do you want of it?
Just the last stanza.
It wasn't my not weighing anything so much as my not knowing anything. My brother had been nearer right before. I had not taken the first step to knowledge. I had not learned to let go with the hands, as still I had not learned to with the heart, and have no wish to with the heart not need, that I can see. The mind is not the heart. I may yet live as I know others live, to wish in vain to let go with the mind, of cares at night to sleep, but nothing tells me that I need to learn to let go with the heart.
Thank you. Isn't that lovely? Anyway, that's the companion poem for Birches, because it's about a girl, okay? And it's called Wild Grapes. Thank you. Thank you, guys. I was just reading about Eleanor here. Well, it's okay. I talk here about Twilight, privately printed, excuse me, here. Early in the fall of 1894, her final year at the university. She was only at the university, St. Lawrence University, for 3 years. And then she graduated. I got a copy of her transcript. It's just amazing the stuff that she took in those 3 years. She took a lot of math and all that. And I think people the biographers have tended to underrate her, in my opinion. He knew what she was worth. Including Twilight. Interpreting Eleanor's discomfort as a rejection, R.F. destroyed his copy. R.F. tried to lose himself in the dismal swamp of North Carolina. After several harrowing incidents, finding himself lost and without money, he called on his mother to help him find his way home. Although exhausted and frightened, he was elated to discover his My Butterfly and Elegy had appeared on the front page of the Independent. That's November 8th, 1894. Where he would continue to publish. Despite R.F.'s dramatic tactics to win Eleanor's hand, or perhaps because of them, she agreed to marry him 1 year later, having completed her degree in 3 years as planned. Once married, Eleanor focused her attention on the goal she and her husband had set for themselves, to enjoy a life of poetry together. She hated the kitchen, she really did. Eleanor had become her husband's number one partner, not as a helpmeet for genius, which is often what she was called, but as a perceptive ear for the beautiful music of his poetry. He shared with her each poem as it was written. In a practical sense, as he stated, she had a perfect ear for vowel sounds. Now, if you're not a poet, that doesn't mean much, but if you're a poet, it means a lot. It was to her the children went for comfort and understanding. She shared with Robert a constant preoccupation with family illness and financial worries. Her death in 1938 deprived the four children, especially the more troubled ones, Carol and Irma, the uninterrupted support they needed and craved. So that's my little pitch for Eleanor today. But he wrote some wonderful love poems. And in England, for some reason, they've acknowledged that. But over here, I don't see much about it. We don't have time to read very many of those, but A Witness Tree has a number of them in there, Carpe Diem and so forth. I urge you to pay a little attention to that. Let's see if I can find one that I have did bring with me. Let's see. Yeah, this is a good one. If you're looking for a love poem for a wedding, here's one for you, which is one of the ones I really like. In fact, a friend of mine did use it at her son's wedding for the, what did they call the dinner the night before the wedding? Yeah, well, she got up and recited this poem by heart, which is even I cannot do, so. She said it was perfect. Everybody cried. Okay, this poem is called The Master Speed. Do any of you know that poem, The Master Speed? It's a good love poem. No speed of wind or water rushing by, but you have speed far greater. You can climb back up a stream of radiance to the sky and back through history up the stream of time. And you were given this swiftness, not for haste, nor chiefly that you may go where you will, but in the rush of everything to waste, that you may have the power of standing still, off any still or moving thing to say, you say. Let me say that again. Off any still or moving thing you say. Two such as you, with such a master speed, cannot be parted nor swept away from one another, once you are agreed that life is only life forevermore, together wing to wing and oar to oar. Now, if you ever go to the burial site in Bennington, has anybody been there? Well, I know a couple of you have. The line, together wing to wing and oar to oar, is under Eleanor's name. And what's under his name, do you remember? Anybody remember?
I had a lover's quarrel with the world.
Yes.
Lover's quarrel.
And I just looking at it this time, I remember that I have is at the beginning. I had forgotten that the I have was at the beginning. I have a lover's quarrel with the world. That's good. That's from a different poem. That's not from this poem. But that line that he put under hers is from this poem, The Master Speed. This is a great place to stop. I've stopped. Thank you for being such a good audience. Mark, did you want to have people ask questions, or is that enough? Well, a couple of questions, if they're good, yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
I love how you finished with the oars.
Yeah.
The oar would be the world we build, and wings.
It's beautiful. I've just finished reading The Boys in the Boat. Have you ever read that? Yeah. Anybody here read The Boys in the Boat? What did you think of it?
It's an amazing story.
It's a great story. And what made me think of one of Frost's poems called The Axe Helm. Has anybody read The Axe Helm? It's one of the poems I would quote to you about his ideas on education, because it's about a French-Canadian man named Baptiste who makes axe helves. And I've discovered with my older students that most of them do not know what an axe helve is. I was shocked by that. Now, who here will admit that they do not know what an axe helve is? You admit it? Well, it's the handle of the axe. It's made of wood, okay. And Baptiste was somebody who carved the handle for the what is called a helve. That's the word for it, H-E-L-V-E. And it's used as a metaphor in that poem that called the axe, and that's the title of the poem, the axe helve. But the metaphor is, of course, that the way he carves the handle is it was with the grain, with the grain, with the grain. And then he tried to keep the children from going to school, because he and both, and of course the narrator, the poet, does not like the idea of laid on education, superimposed. And that's why he hated school. When he talked about going to school at Harvard, and he was there for, with honors there as well. His father was Phi Beta Kappa at Harvard, so he knew a lot about education. But after he'd gone there, he had to leave because his mother became ill with cancer and died shortly thereafter in 1900. So he didn't stay to graduate. And what was I going to say? He always would refer to Harvard as where he was a patient. That's where I was a patient. He felt that way even more so at Dartmouth. He was there briefly at Dartmouth right after he graduated from high school and before. And when he discovered that Eleanor was not going to marry him until she went to college, so he went off to Dartmouth because his parents thought that his grandparents did not want him to go to Harvard because they thought that Harvard had ruined his father, who died of consumption, of course, when he was 10 years old. But he ended up at Harvard because he needed to get some kind of education so he could make a living. And his grandfather had helped him out, but his grandfather said to him, "We got to get this poetry stuff out of you because this is not leading to a happy family situation when you're having children and so on." Little did he know that it was not going to work out, that the poultry business was going to be what he stuck with. But he always talked about going to Harvard as being a patient there. But the boys in the boat reminded me of that poem because it's that love of the shells, the man that made the shells. You're the one that read it. Pollock, I think his name was. Pollock is his name. And all the shells that were used for rowing at that time, this is 1934, 36, 38, and from then on, all of them were built by hand by this man alone. Nobody helped him. And when he described to one of the rowers what it was like to make them, it was like, you know, almost a religious experience for him. He used different kinds of woods, and they had to smooth them in a certain way. And these shells were beautiful. They were very thin, and to row them was very difficult. Anyway, the University of Washington crew won the gold medal at the 1936 Olympics in Berlin. And this story is all about how this group of boys got together, and some of their lives are treated in great detail. It's a wonderful book. I recommend it. The last name is Brown. I can't remember the first name. Do you remember the first name of the author? The last name of the author is Brown, but I don't remember the first name. Boys in the Boat. You can't miss it. But anyways, that love of the... that's what reminded me of the Axel, because it's that love of the grain. And of course, he uses it as a metaphor for education. You have some of that in the... Death of the Hired Man also, when they talk about the college kid that is daft on education and so on. And so Frost always said, you know, I'm always telling them to get going. And one of his students did take off when he was told to, and he went to Brazil, and he became quite a noted man in the government of Brazil. This was many years ago, obviously. And when Frost started teaching at Pinkerton Academy. And then, of course, he had two students that married, and they went off to Vancouver in British Columbia, and there he wanted to go. So when they were meeting at Plymouth State College in 1912, he and his wife and his four children were standing in the kitchen deciding what to do to get away from all these distractions known as education. He said, "I want to go to Vancouver with these two students whom he liked very much." And they had gone to Vancouver, dropping out of Middlebury, and went to Vancouver in order to write. They wanted to get some writing done. Went off into the woods, they would get some writing. So he said to Eleanor and the children, I don't care where we go, but I want to go to Vancouver. And she said, no, I want to go to England, because I want to live under Thatch. That wasn't something, she didn't know anybody in England, nobody knew anybody in England. He had read the lyric poets, of course, he knew them very well, but she was the one that wanted to go to England, and they decided it literally with a toss of a coin. That was it. They're standing in the kitchen in Plymouth, they tossed a coin, and England came up. You can always, you know, wonder what would have happened if they had, if he'd gone to Vancouver. I think he would have been recognized. There was someone in Maine about to publish him too, but England was a perfect place for him because he never met a poet before. That was a brand new experience for him. And there were poets everywhere at that point. It was a real renaissance of poetry, and he met them in London, and it all took off. Okay, is that enough? Got it? What, one more question? Come on. There.
What was he like to hang out with?
Say that again.
Was he grumpy? Was he...
Oh, my grandfather, you mean?
Yes.
Well, people ask me that question, and I'm always hesitant to answer, and I'll tell you why. He was a hard-working man into his 88th year. 88, when he died. And he was, first place, poets don't get paid well. Even when he was teaching, he would have lectureship jobs. 2,000 a year, 3,000 a year. And he's got troubled children, four children to help raise. And Eleanor, of course, wasn't working. So financially, it was a tough haul for him. And he kept on doing it, kept on doing it. The way he made money was teaching and also by doing readings. Excuse me, I should stand here. So I don't know how to answer that. I found him extraordinarily fascinating. When I was very young, I didn't know he was a famous poet, but by the time I was maybe in elementary school, probably I did, because people would mention it, you know. But I never made that much of it. And then we would go visit him up in Breadloaf and Ripton. At Cambridge, and of course, Alicia and I, there's my classmate. She and I had a chance to go over to his house and study there, you know, when I was at Radcliffe and all that. And he had a wonderful dog then that I liked, Gilly, so on. So he was very informal. We never talked about, things that people think he would talk about. Occasionally he did talk about poetry. We talked about Invictus was a poem that he especially liked, and which, by the way, I have a first edition of that poem by Henley, and it had no title. That poem had no title. I don't know who put the title on it, Invictus. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul.
Out of the night. Yes,
thank you. Out of the night, yeah.
Out of the night.
It's a great poem. And so he would talk about that. He said, just because a poem's popular doesn't mean it's bad, you know? So we talk about poetry sometimes, but mostly it was just about family things and so on. And when he was in Ripton, of course, he had the cabin, and it was small enough that no one else could stay there. There was no chance of anybody else staying there. So people would go up the hill and talk to him, and he'd come back down. And then the Homer Noble farm there, the Morrisons had their family there. And so he'd come down for some meals and so on. So it was very informal. And then he had a place in South Miami, which he called Pencil Pines, and they were just two little prefabricated houses. They looked like sort of like trailers right next to each other. And he would be in one, and then he'd have, you know, family or relatives or just friends stay in the other one. But he loved it down there in what he called the pneumonia season. He would get on the train with his dog and he'd go all the way to Florida. He stopped and spoke 26 times in Chapel Hill. He spoke 26 times at Agnes Scott next to Atlanta. So he stopped, you know, they got to know him and, you know, made a big deal out of it. Agnes Scott has a very lovely small collection of Frost, has a statue of him in the garden and so on. Most people don't know that. I have a niece back there who lives in Atlanta, so that's why I'm mentioning Atlanta. But he would stop in those places. In Chapel Hill, he was very close friend with the chair of the English department there, Clifford Lyons, and he'd met Clifford at the University of Florida, actually, in Gainesville. So he'd go down there in the middle of winter, he'd go down there, and then he'd go up here to Breadloaf in the summer, and then Cambridge was his real home, Cambridge, 35 Brewster Street. So we, you know, we'd catch up with him, you know, but you remember, this was a man on the move. He went to Russia, he went to Jerusalem and all that those last years. He was in Russia just very close to when he died, and Kennedy let him go there, but he wasn't too happy with what he said when he came back. But he spent 2 hours with Khrushchev and the translator. Does that sort of answer the question? I mean, it's a hard question to answer like that. Very informal. He was a family man. He was a very good family man. He took very good care of every time he had any money, he gave it to his children. What can I say? Okay.